I decided that when friends tell me about their sexual exploits, the first question I'm always going to ask is, was he or she a generous lover? Because I think it's a very telling question. Did we start recording?
Yes. Yeah, we're recording.
You're listening to the Noon 15 podcast. I'm your host, Dan Cole, and in this special Halloween edition, we'll talk about At the Festival, the epic 22-minute suite, written almost exclusively by Harry Nichols, performed and perfected by all band members, and recorded with Chris Ploss at Sunwood Studios in Trumansburg. At the end of this episode, you'll hear the suite in its mastered form. Thanks for listening, and welcome to Noon 15, the podcast. And we're here for the special edition of the Noon 15 podcast. I'm joined today by Mandy Goldman.
Something like this, you really can create a very fleshed out dramatic piece because you have players as vessels for that story, and necessarily everyone will interpret it differently.
Samuel B. Lupowitz.
Part of it was figuring out how to approach it like it was one piece, but also being able to focus in on the different sections and give them all their own flavor so you go on a journey with them.
Joe Massa?
Yes, exactly, which featured a lot of rehearsed, dueling, busy lead guitar stuff.
Harry Nichols?
I wanted to do something even more grandiose, just see like how far I could take it.
Phil Shea?
You know, pain is a good reminder of how not to do something.
And owner of Sunwood Studios, Chris Ploss, who lended his talents to this project as well.
I really wanted to just try to internalize your vision and coax the best performances out of you for each of the elements that we added.
We're here today to talk about At the Festival. And there's kind of a how to eat an elephant element to broaching this subject. All I can come up with is, Harry, what the hell happened here? Was this like, did you set out to write something like this? Was it a collection of lyrics and a collection of tunes that you then put together? Or what happened here, man?
The short story is that when we began Noon 15, I decided it was going to be a project where I try to push things for myself as a songwriter. And I knew that I wanted to, I had done suites in the past with my band, Harry Nichols Band. We did a Star Wars suite called Dear George, and I had a lot of fun writing and producing that. Yeah, I wanted to do something even more grandiose, just see like how far I could take it.
So it was kind of like, let's do something really intense here.
Yeah. No, so I set out with the intention of creating something really, really big. But the fact that it was this song and you know, this story that like kind of became that, that kind of happened more by chance. Like I just kind of started writing, I knew I wanted to make something big eventually. And then I started writing a song, and it just never seemed to be done.
Yeah. Kind of like chicken or egg. I mean, so it sounds like the music kind of came first from the sound of it, and you put the lyrics to it, or was it more piece by piece how it came together?
Because
we're talking about a song in eight parts here.
Right. You know? No, it was idea and theme first.
Okay.
I had been to a music festival where I was with a friend who had been experiencing some loss at the time, and he just kind of seemed renewed at the music festival, and I wanted to sort of capture that, you know, whatever it is that caused that transformation in him in a song.
Because renewal, of course, means there's a down point also.
Right. But also, yeah, and also just because I just had a hard time writing a song that was just like, somebody died, but then I came and saw this band, and now I'm great. You know, it's just not, it's not reality.
You've been holding out on us with that version.
I know, we should have done that.
That's an instant.
That would have been good.
And claps.
Right, exactly.
I haven't been this drunk in years, so hand me the cheap wine and cheaper beers. The band is blasting out my ears, but you and I don't need to hear.
So that's why it spiraled and it became something a little more nuanced, I hope.
Yeah, okay.
I remember, like, early, a few months after we started the band, Mandy and I were over at your place, and you're like, oh, I want to play you this thing I've been working on. And you played the demo of, I guess, the first like four sections is what you had. And it, I mean, as is your want, like, it sounds a lot like the record wound up sounding. And maybe I'm just having one bad year. And maybe it's time to move on from here. And I could have sworn I was 20 yesterday. How did time all get away? I mean, there are different things there, but it was just the sections, the transitions, all the way up through about 15 minutes in, and then you were like, yeah, and that's where I'm at right now.
Yeah. Well, that's, I mean, this was years ago, by the way. Like, we've been working on this for years.
Yeah.
And, you know, so it was pre-kids, and that's just, that's what I do for fun when I get the time to myself, is I just hash out demo recordings and make them as, like, I don't know, thought out as possible, even if what doesn't end up happening on the real recording, or even if what happens doesn't end up being.
But that's all the process, right?
Working right, exactly. Yeah, yeah. So it's just, it's fun for me, and so I work on it in spare time. And so, you know, sometimes I invite friends over, and I'm just like, come here. Here's 15 minutes of absurdity.
Very nice. Moving over to Phil as the backbone of this, really. I mean, what's your approach to something that changes this often? You know, we have eight different parts here, eight different themes. What do you see as your role kind of keeping it all steady in the meantime?
It's a good question, Dan. Thank you. you know, it's it is an interesting question. I just, with something like this, I just had to internalize it and just like muscle memory, you know. And I did, once I stopped thinking about it, that really helped.
Fair enough. Just let it come out. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just, you know, it's classic Harry and Sam, you know. It's like my part in this band is just to play the really crazy stuff that they throw at me.
Do you find opportunities to add your own style to it also?
Yeah. You know, I had a bit of complaining early on.
yeah, but you joined the band in like day three of getting together with us. You were like, yeah, I'm ready to play that. We were like, oh, okay.
We're not ready to play it anymore.
Yeah. I was going to say, you got it pretty quick for muscle memory. I feel like you got it like the first time.
Yeah. You know, the first time we played it, it definitely like clicked. And then I'm like, oh, great. I'm not going to be able to do that again for a while. You know, like sometimes that seems to happen with me. It's like, okay. Hopefully, you know, I try not to do that too often, you know, to exceed expectations, because you just like set the bar too high. And I'm like, yeah, I like good. To slack a little bit in life, you know, so.
So, Harry, like you mentioned, this has been kicking around for years. I mean, I remember the last time you guys were on Tuesdays with the band, I was hearing about the suite. I remember that because I made a really bad joke on the air about it. And that was easily 3 years ago.
Oh, yeah, you were like, that new project is really
pretty
sweet.
Yeah, well, I'm really glad you remembered that.
I remember it. Yeah.
But what can you say about when it seemed like it really kicked into gear once Phil was on board? I mean, would this have been possible without him? What can you say about that?
We had it like pretty much learned with our old drummer. But it was still really early on in the band, and I don't know, like, we were still just trying to do a lot at once at the same time, and still kind of learning each other's, you know, styles and instincts and stuff. And so it was just never that, it was never tight, even when it was together. And did we ever play it?
Never the whole thing. We played sections of it out, but the first time we played the whole thing was Phil's first gig
at Atlas Bowl.
Yeah.
In T-Bird.
That's right.
Yes, nothing for like a Greek tragedy inspired rock opera, like a bowling alley,
like an empty bowling alley,
empty bowling
on a Monday night.
That's what Pete Townsend was all about,
and Marty Fartione.
Yeah, right.
Props to Marty. Marty, if you're listening,
Marty's our biggest fan.
He timed it for us that night.
Yeah,
he did.
He did.
What kind of challenges and rewards exist in recording a 22-minute song?
I'm always the one who has like, who's always pushing the band to do really like bold things to the point of just unnecessary difficulty. I'm like, hey, how much do we want to break it down when we record it? Do we want to play the whole thing? Do we want to do it in three? And then like everyone's like, maybe if we do it in small sections, we'll play it better and it'll be more, and everyone pulls me to the center and then it's cool. But I think that was part of it, was figuring out how to approach it like it was one piece, but also being able to focus in on the different sections and give them all their own flavor. So it, you go on a journey with it.
Yeah.
I was thinking about mixing it kind of all in one project, and I just ran out of tracks. That was that was a challenge.
Yeah.
So I broke it down into its kind of constituent parts, even though we tracked it all in one big project.
Okay.
Some of the sections were tracked contiguously, but we kind of focused in on each one and kind of recorded them in order.
And Chris, have you worked on a project quite like this before?
No, not quite like this. This was my first rock opera.
What was your reaction? I mean, I can imagine some excitement, but they said we're bringing in this thing. Like, what was your take on it?
It was fun to, you know, set up. My mind is some of it's the big picture, but a lot of it's just the minutia. So like, not until they really started playing it live, was I like, oh. Okay, I get it now.
I see what you're doing here.
Yeah, I see what you're doing. So, yeah, it was really fun.
Nice. And we had talked before in some of the past podcasts about kind of the balance of recording live versus bit by bit and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And it seems that that's kind of a common theme, striking that balance.
Yeah.
Having a couple just solid live runs and then honing in on some other things as you go.
Yeah.
As the rest of the band, other than Harry, I mean, I would think it, to me, it speaks to your respect and faith in him that you're even willing to attempt this. You know, what can you guys say about that?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Well, it was amazing. The first time Sam and I heard it, we were both just absolutely blown away. And we were playing like the unfinished demo for people because we were
just so psyched about it.
Yeah, it was so amazing. And it's so exciting to get to do something like this. And not everybody's bandmates give them opportunities to like create a character and sing a story. Something that's very much unlike what you're hearing elsewhere.
And just a quick rundown here of what we have on this piece. It's produced and performed, of course, by Noon 15. Mandy Goldman on the vocals. Samuel B. Lupowitz on keys and vocals. There's a lot more to what Sam's doing that we're going to get to also. Joe Massa on all sorts of guitars. Harry Nichols on bass, percussion, and vocals. Phil Shea on drums and vocals. Chris Ploss even on tambourine and vocals. It was recorded and mixed by Chris right here at Sunwood Recording in Trumansburg. Additional recording by Sam. Mastered by Matsukuchi Murano at Scaramanga Industries.
It's the name of the Christopher
Bond villain,
yeah,
right?
yeah, Christopher Lee's villain in The Man with the Golden Gun, which is known as being like one of the worst Bond movies. But it's Christopher Lee.
And artwork for the album that we have yet to see, or at least I have yet to see, by J.P. Feenstra.
Oh, yeah. I can't wait to see it either.
So the first part here, Time For Me, it kind of sets the tone, if you will, for the whole thing. Take some time for me. Take us through this, Harry. What did you want to accomplish, I guess, lyrically in this section in particular?
I mean, this is, so I started, when I started writing it, I started right at the top, and this was before it had kind of spiraled out of control. And so I was just trying to, you know, illustrate this idea of a person sort of being renewed through this experience, and what I think it would take to, you know, have that, basically. And so you've got a character who has arrived, at, you know, having had a loss recently in the past, and just sort of deciding, he's kind of stuck between the idea of sticking around and lingering on it, or moving on and just, you know, sort of abandoning the care and the baggage of that experience.
Yeah, but like
time for me to figure this out. Also, like time for me, you know, as opposed to possibly other people or something else. You know?
Yeah, and this first part has a very smooth kind of mellow feel to it, and it segues right into the weight of things, which really picks it up a little bit.
Right.
And Joe, in the first part, Time For Me, if you will, in the chorus of that section, you would turn from the smooth guitar into some distortion.
I think that was kind of already a pre-written thing by Harry.
Oh,
so
wow.
I kind of was just trying to go on what he kind of had on his on the original demo. I think it was kind of distorted guitar. It's been a long time since I listened to it, but yeah, I was basically playing at that part what he had written.
Fair enough. Cool. So the weight of things, like I said, where things really pick up, and here's where we hear Mandy take over on lead vocals for a section. Is this, Mandy, for you almost like acting, like you're playing a particular character in this story? You know, what can you say about that?
That's definitely how I approached it. The first time we listened through it, we kind of asked Harry to lay out the story for us. And yeah, I decided that what was more important in my performances in this piece was the character than like pretty singing.
Okay.
Yeah. So tried to get really...
I mean, it sounds great. You know.
Well, thank you. But yeah, like I wanted it to have some real investment in the character behind it.
Who did you see your character being in this part?
I see her as kind of like the girl you meet in the grassroots, like offsite campground, like when you're tripping and you like at a festival and you meet like some super hot girl and she like you have like one crazy ride together and then she's gone. So that's sort of how I saw it. It's like I saw her as like a like hippie spirit guide kind of thing.
Yeah. And so Joe and Phil kind of picked up the tempo here, you know, and did their part to really pick this thing up. What did you do to keep up the energy in the studio, you know?
Well, I think we did this take like a lot of, where we were like, we had a lot of time to like get me set up for this. So I went through it a bunch of times and I was like, kind of every time I went through it, we were like, no, we should really be like, go harder than that. Like,
okay.
Because I think in the studio, I still have like a tendency to like, I want to back off the mic a little bit. I don't want to be screaming my head off because it feels very close when you're in the studio sometimes, right in front of the mic. But we just kind of kept going at it sort of harder and harder. And as I was sort of checking the mic, Harry was able to give me some kind of energy notes. But I think it was like mostly just getting really into the character. I have a background in the musical theater.
Well, we had talked in part one of the Finish What You Started podcast, available now on iTunes and noon15.com, about how you kind of had to get away from the musical theater background of like stand and deliver, as you put it, right?
Yeah.
And that this is like, you talked a lot about Diva Mandy, and that's what I feel like we're hearing here, you know?
Yeah, definitely. It's like I could just kind of go balls to the wall with this section. It's like, it's such a good rock song. So I could really just kind of like wail it out and really not kind of worry about, I'm always worried about preserving my voice, but I was like, nah, like sometimes it's great when you're in the studio to just kind of throw technique out the window a little bit. Sorry, Lisa, my voice teacher, but throw technique out the window and just kind of go nuts.
Well, you really can pull out all the stops. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
And so, Joe, on this one in particular, you've got three guitars listed, the Gibson Les Paul, Fender Stratocaster, and the Ibanez Electric 12-string. How was each of those useful to you here? Like, what was it, for example, about the Strat that made you want to add that to the mix? Because the Les Paul shows up most frequently for you, but
yeah.
What did you get out of each guitar in this case?
So, basically, what I did during the solo, this song, this whole piece, really, but this section in particular, is like the closest thing to stuff I played like 10, 12, 15 years ago that probably only you have really heard me play.
Between Walls, et cetera.
Yes, yeah. Exactly, which featured a lot of rehearsed, dueling, busy lead guitar stuff. And I find that that tends to work better when you have slightly different guitar sounds. So in that section where there's the two lead guitars going, I sort of use the Strat to balance out the Les Paul a little bit with a little bit of a thinner, more biting tone where the Les Paul's for.
Yeah.
As far as the 12 string, that was more of just like a sort of texture thing that I was hearing in my head. Just another, because that part is so dense and thick.
Yeah.
I feel like you can't have enough instruments playing that progression.
Just another layer. Yeah.
That high shimmery thing you do in the choruses with the 12 string, I think is just so inspired, because we'll talk a lot about how Harry's demo is such a clear blueprint for how to do this, but like you did a lot of little things in there that help build the texture.
Yeah, and there was definitely,
I never would have thought of that.
There was definitely trial and error in there too, because I was originally just going to play the exact same thing that I was playing on the rhythm guitar, but then I heard that and that was just like sort of clashing a little bit too much, and putting my head together with Chris and Sam and Harry and everybody, we sort of arrived at just holding out those half notes.
Yeah,
and just sort of let it ring, and it has a sort of high shimmery quality on top of the dirty, cluttered guitars.
How do you decide which one to play when you do it live? Because you do switch between guitars during this song?
No.
No. Well, then I'm wrong. Okay.
I haven't yet, anyway. Who knows? Yeah. Now you got me thinking.
We're going to have to buy you a double neck guitar.
Yeah, right.
That's what it boils down to.
I'll take it if you're going to buy it.
Yeah, right. You know what I mean? Phil, I know you're trying to buy a house right now, but listen. Imagine Joe with a double neck guitar.
And so, Harry, back to same idea here, really. What did you kind of take us through way to things? Like what did this section mean to you? What did you want to get out of it? How did you want to come out of it to go into the next one, you know?
Yeah, well, I mean, the first two sections are kind of opposites of the same coin. You've got the first section was about being very, very pensive and wondering whether you should, you know, abandon the baggage of grief. And then the second section is very much just like being convinced to abandon the baggage of grief.
Okay.
And that's kind of like the main character's like, it's kind of his problem, I think, and it's just waffling back and forth, indecision.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that probably leads us into the chaos of the next section.
Into your chaos, perfection, I will fall.
Chaos, perfection would be section number 3, and I've been racking my brain to come up with an appropriate Jeff Goldblum reference to talk about the chaos section, but I've not been able to do it. So if anyone has any suggestions, I'm open to it. But
Dino droppings? Dino droppings? Sorry, that's my best.
Chris Ploss finds a way.
Yeah.
There it is. There it is. Thank you. All right.
Oh, boy.
As we go through this, Harry, I hear some elements of Harry Nichols' band. I hear an element or two of Baku. What can you say about how your history has kind of shown up in bits and pieces of this? Or am I the only one that sees that?
Can you tell me how you hear Baku in it? I'm just curious.
Darling of mine.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I see. And you show me everything you want me to know. I am not what you want. You are not what I need. I
can't show what you feed me to. Your machine poison with perfect. Not Chaos Perfection specifically, but the whole thing.
Got it,
I hear a lot of like your past elements.
I was just curious. I think if I have a sound, it's just the Beach Boys, basically. Washy vocals, you know, and melody.
And then whatever musical style goes along with that.
Mm-hmm. And whatever musical style goes along, exactly. And then in this one, I think I just, because it's very convenient that I think the Beach Boys are actually kind of a good reference point for some of what Noon 15 just does naturally. Mm-hmm. So in Chaos Perfection, I was really, I mean, that's, you know, we got that shaker in there. We have that sort of, what kind of reverb is on that bass? And then like, bing, bing, bing.
It's kind
bing,
of a, bing, bing. It's kind of like a slap delay.
Like slap
but
back.
And that's not something you normally would throw on bass, but I was trying to harken back to that kind
yeah,
of
yeah, it's definitely
old,
got that
old time
little like Carol K
it totally yeah, works that. For yeah like some good vibrations type you know shit going on there, so yeah, they totally worked for me. And and so yeah, so that section is just me kind of doing that because it's just so convenient to have that be an actual sound that we can just have in this band.
You know? Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And yeah, like you had said, this was kind of the first part was really kind of tight-laced, if you will. The second part was a little bit more upbeat, and it's like one side against the other one, and this is where it kind of, no, but the chaos is okay.
Right.
Right, is that kind of what we get out of
yeah,
this?
Yeah, we're sort of embracing the chaos here. Yeah. And yeah, sort of wandering off. That's kind of the sound of it.
Yeah.
On, you know, drugs.
Right, so right.
It is a music festival after
right, right, right.
Yeah, drugs are a very important part of this story.
Many stories.
Many stories, yes.
And that little whisper at the end of the word perfection as you sing it, man. Just that's oh, wonderful.
Thanks, into your chaos perfection I will fold.
You know, you've done some sort of featured vocals in this band so far, but it was nice to get that you, we did something that where you had so much space to just get to sing because you have some fantastic vocals.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. It's good to, it's good to be able to sing leads and, yeah. You know, have the leads be able to be shared is really cool too. So
yeah,
hashtag blessed, am I right?
Hashtag blessed.
Something that, again, we had talked about in past podcasts was kind of how it's not necessarily important to be able to pull off live what you do in the studio. Because like Harry, you in particular talked about your studio time is just like, it is what it is, right? Make the best of it. Do you think you would have gone this far with this if you weren't confident that you could also play it live?
I would have. I love the act and art of recording and making records is just one of my favorite things in the entire world. And I have a really hard time stopping once I get started. So, and it doesn't take a lot of convincing for me to just be like, oh no, let's do that. You know?
Yeah.
He kind of put that much effort into the demo. Right. I'm sure we'll be, I'm like insert interspersed cut of the demo here. Yeah. with a wind chime. Yeah, the demo is really, really intricate, which I think is part of the reason that we all knew what to do. It was really a blueprint for the finished product.
Nice.
But also, I mean, I think we, so much of, again, like my, the push and pull of our different, you know, the different things that we've been trying to do, I've put such an emphasis on, like, making sure that we're a live band and a live unit, and I really like... Because we were able to take this really far in the studio and adding textures, but again, like what makes it consistent with some of the other things we've done, even though compositionally it's a lot more ambitious, is that we did still like we played it out, we honed it as a group, and we really had the chance to put our stamp on it as a 5-piece band playing the material and then sculpt it from there rather than completely. Assembling it in the studio.
Yeah. Would you say from playing it out, you maybe learned or discovered some things
sure.
that you could then use for the recording you wouldn't have seen otherwise?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'd like to remark at how kind of efficient the session was. Like we really banged those tracks out very quickly, and I feel like that wouldn't have been possible if you hadn't had it already rehearsed like to be performed live. Mm-hmm. And then it was a nice platform, yeah, on which to build.
It's my favorite way. Yeah.
How many sessions did this take total? Like three? Three sessions?
Like wow. The whole day. Like it
yeah,
was,
the whole
you know,
day.
10 a.m. to...
Did we get all the basics done in a single day?
Yes.
Yep.
And started the overdubs that night. We yeah. did some extra guitars and vocals
yeah,
and
we
stuff.
Got the skeleton, the core structure of everybody playing together all the way wow. through done in a single day.
And then, yeah, I think cool. there were like maybe three additional... And I did a bunch of my like synthesizer and organ overdubs I did on my own, so that saved us. You know, we weren't all... here in the studio, but we did most of it here, which was really which was not the plan going in, but became part of the what made the experience so great was getting to hang with Chris in a much nicer, more equipped, more expansive space than we'd been making records up to this point.
Part 4 is Wandering. It's a very good segue part. you know, kind of from one section into the next. And I feel like this could have been nothing but vocals, really. You know, I mean, the instrumentation obviously adds a lot, but the vocals are what's at the heart of it there. What can you say about kind of using vocals as alone as an arrangement tool?
I mean, it's my first instinct when it comes time to flesh things out. And I think I think when I first imagined this section, it beyond just like the bass and drums, the vocals were the next thing I knew I wanted to have in there.
Yeah.
You know, and then when, you know, I was just loving the feel of those vocals and the pad and the motion of it all. And I just wanted to keep it going. So I layer on more vocals and more vocals. And
we got this section as the featured Phil Shea vocal amongst the vocal pad, which yeah. we talked yeah, a lot about right. last podcast about starting to get Phil in.
Yeah.
And this was the first thing that we played with Phil. And we were like, now you're going to sing the fourth of this, oh, yeah. this intricate four part like harmony. Yeah.
You know, and then I just wanted to keep going. So I was like, all right, let's have a guitar solo as well. And, you know,
which
it kind of explodes there.
That's my favorite part of the suite.
Oh, that's
and,
good.
Yeah, I feel like it might be early to say that. But I'm confident because, like, Joe's solo there is amazing. And it, like, moves me, like, an almost embarrassing amount live.
When we were firing up the Leslie to run the guitar, that right? That's what
yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. 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 Guitar through the yeah. Leslie speaker.
We put the guitar through the Leslie speaker. I was like, that's when I started getting like the inkling that this was going to turn out like way, way more awesome than I had imagined, which is like, it's pretty rare for me. I've done a lot of recording and a lot of times things either meet or fall below my expectations. That's usually, you know.
You don't blow yourself away very often.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I think that's a testament to just having good people around you. You know, you just, that's the only thing that can make that happen. The only thing that can make it exceed your expectations is having other amazing people around you.
It's the great thing about this band. I feel like we all, it's such a mutual admiration society. So like everybody just really committed, and then recording it was like a dream because we were all just like in the control room, like squeeing over each other's performances, like, oh my God, that was so good.
And Joe, the solo in this section, Wandering, has come up already. Something like this, kind of knowing where it has to go, right? What it has to segue into the next section. Do you kind of work backward, like figure out how it's going to go into the next section first and then go back from there, or just start going and feel it out and however it goes?
I've never. That's an interesting method. I might consider that in the future. But no, I just sort of went with it and, you know, got to know the piece better and took it from there, kind of.
Was there anything in particular you wanted out of this solo?
To sort of support but enhance what was happening vocally before that, if that makes sense. Sort
yeah.
of complement but enhance it.
Yeah.
So I didn't want... I thought for a while about like actually composing something that was like, you know, a guitar melody as opposed to a guitar solo, but nothing really struck me as I was working through it. So I did my best to try and make it, you know, something that could be sung
okay.
as opposed to something too terribly technical and too many notes. And
it's a pretty unique effect that you use there too.
Yeah, that's the Leslie.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what that brings to it.
Yes.
I had just assumed that the strat through the Leslie was Sam's idea because Sam Lupowitz.
Right. For once, it wasn't
Sam
my
Leslie
idea
to put
something through a Leslie. I think, I don't remember.
Chris just said, I have a Leslie, and guitar sounds really good through it.
I was like, let's give this a try.
Nice.
And I was like, okay. And Sam's like, yes. That's kind of how that went.
No disagreement, obviously. Yeah.
I think you could put anything through a Leslie and Sam be all right with it.
Yes.
We could test that.
I was like, I was imagining something like farting into one. Of course. Or like putting up a cat to it and be like,
it's about what it would sound like.
Yeah. I'm actually surprised you haven't tried that at home. Let's get the Leslie out here.
Let's get the Leslie and the cat.
See what, see how many things we can put into it.
Oh boy.
And Sam, so I feel like the key and organ layers ended up almost rivaling the vocal layers in this section for you. Kind of take us through that, you know?
Yeah, well, and it's funny because compared to some of the other sections, this doesn't have the most kind of layered keyboards. I did do, I think, so, other than the vocals, I think sort of the key, like, musical motive in the section is that guitar arpeggio that just sort of keeps rolling through. And live, I sort of always split the difference playing electric piano, like following that guitar movement, but also filling out the chord a little bit more. So I did layer, there are two electric piano parts on this, and one is pretty much, you don't really hear it as so much as it becomes part of the guitar sound. It just blends with that guitar motion, and then the other electric piano is just sort of filling out the space and adding to the chord supporting the vocal. But the other big keyboard element of this section, sort of to speak to what Harry's been talking about, but one of my favorite things about this band is how we'll all piggyback on each other's ideas, no matter how like half-baked or in passing they are. And Harry was like, I hear sort of a churchy organ on that part. And I'd just been, you know, when that big climactic moment happens during the guitar solo, I'd been going to a big Hammond organ chord, which is what I do a lot when things need to get big because it works. But he said church organ, and I was like, well, like I could just kind of find a gospel-y registration on the organ, or I could do what I wound up doing, which is I booked one of the chapels at Cornell University and stuck a couple of microphones in the room and played their pipe organ. And that's one of my favorite things I've ever gotten to do as a musician, because you really like the instrument is you're just playing a giant room. That's what it was. It's such a cool thing to get to add, and I think really helps. There's a real element of surprise, that in that lift there. And I just had a ball making that much noise and getting to actually put it on a record. And that someone let me, like someone who has studied playing classical organ, let me play it. I'm like, all right, well, I can, if you stand aside, I know you've been here playing Bach, but let me hear, I'm going to hit a big chord and it's going to be loud and I'll be happy. That's.
Yeah. That thing is very impressive. The power that comes out of that is just, I can't imagine what it, like you said, it's playing a room. You're not even playing an instrument. Right?
Yeah.
It's just, yeah.
Yeah. Well, just, it just surrounds you completely. And I think you can get a sense of that at least on the record, though. I'll tell you, if you have the chance to just be sitting in the middle of that, it's an experience.
There's a video clip of Sam in the chapel getting ready to record it. And it's like you just got home to your dog after you've been away for a month. That's like the amount of excitement.
Telling a friend about this. I was like, well, we recorded this ambitious piece where my husband got to play a pipe organ and recorded some videos with just a shit-eating grin on his face. And there's like two students behind him in the chapel who are like waiting for him to begin a concert. And he's just playing the same chord over and over.
Giggling.
Trying to get the pedals with my foot. Occasionally not. Like there's a lot of recordings of me playing the organ very badly, but it got that moment.
So to segue into then Darling of Mine part 5 here.
Darling of mine, where have you wandered?
And this is an emergence of what I've always been looking for and that I've referred to as Midnight 15. Which is just a little bit on the heavier side here, because once again, these five can do just about anything that they put their minds to. So Mandy, I guess we'll start there. Live and in studio, how do you kind of balance the constant switch between lead and backup? Do you see it as like different characters necessarily? We talked about that a few minutes ago, or?
Yeah, well, in this it's easy because they are at times different characters. They're pretty much, I think it's a different character really in each like movement in each track. This one had that sort of like woodsy vibe to it, where you wanted it to be like voices that you're hearing from afar, almost like voices that you hear through the woods, like something creepy, something mountainous. And all right, I'm gonna get real literary. So like, I kind of puts to mind that like Washington Irving, short stories that he wrote about like colonial America, where he's in the wilds of New York State, at like Rumpelstiltskin. Fuck, Rip Van Winkle. Rip Van Winkle. What's Rumpelstiltskin?
That's that fairy tale about the dude who steals a baby.
That's a really funny thing for me to mix it up with. Rip Van Winkle, they're like playing croquet or something in the forest, and that's kind of what called to mind. So I imagined it being like one voice that had like one voice with many parts, and yeah. Just it having that really homogenous sound to it. And it was really easy to kind of get in that zone because it's such a beautiful melody. And it's not like singing on your own. It's like in any of the sections that I sing backing vocals in this song, it's not a lead vocal. It's something supportive or something textural. So it's a totally different way of going about things. It's not about your own sound.
You guys have a really good blend. Like it's very, it does kind of sound like one big voice.
Because it was both of you the whole time.
It's all three of us.
All three of us on that part, yeah.
Okay.
Quick through the woods, oh love of mine. I'll have you back by morning time.
It thrills me to no end because I appreciate you saying that we have a good blend, because I always feel, we've talked about this before, like I'm very proud to be like third on the ladder of singers in this band, but that's great. But it is sometimes, it can be, and like Phil, I'm sure you can relate to this too, it can be a little intimidating, like trying to do a vocal, this ensemble vocal. I'm like, all right, I have to not make Mandy and Harry sound worse. That's all, if I do that, I'll feel great. But we all kind of, not just vocally, I feel like one of the cool things about this band is we all get those opportunities to really step forward and be at the center of what we're doing and then step back and be ensemble players. And I really like that give and take within our sound.
And I have to pee really badly. Okay. So I'm going to do that.
We'll be right back. Keep that in the red.
Wonder how Mandy's doing right now.
Hopefully okay.
Hopefully she's doing okay.
Yeah.
Honestly, if she gets held up, it'll be because she's petting the dogs.
Yeah.
Right. Could be. Not doing cocaine.
I'm going to say no.
No, petting the dogs is code, actually.
That was what Steven Tyler, big canine fan.
He was a dog petter.
Yeah.
Pet so many damn dogs. 80s.
It's all just a blur of fur.
There was this one night, I swear to God, I must have pet like 75 dogs.
At what point is it no longer a metaphor and it's just...
I saw this one picture of him. I was watching a hip-hop documentary.
And, so obviously Steven Tyler.
Well, no, he popped up because of Run DMC. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And there was a picture of him in the studio doing that song, and he is just so skinny from petting so many fucking dogs. Does not look good.
The thing I read about Steven Tyler and Joe Perry that made me really understand the depths of what their drug use must have been is that Jerry Garcia said about them, I've never seen two guys do so many drugs in my entire life.
I'm sorry, you mean pet so many dogs.
Right, I'm sorry. Damn it. Secrets out. All right.
So Harry, back to kind of the theme here. So the wandering, of course, was there were no real like actual lyrics in there, right? So before Darling of Mine, we came out of Chaos Perfection, when it was like, okay, so it's crazy, but it's okay. So kind of take us through Darling of Mine now. Where are we in this one, and what are we going up to?
So things kind of take a left turn during Wandering. There's no there's no lyrics, as you mentioned, but like it's getting spookier and a little weirder.
Because drugs.
Because drugs, yeah.
And I kind of always assumed there was like a sexual climax at the end of watering.
Oh, sure.
But I don't know if that's what you intended.
That's what I'm gonna do on stage.
All right. Well, got a little carried away here. But.
Oh wow!
Like when the chapel organ comes in, that's the big moment.
I think Phil should get up and mime it.
I don't know. It sounds like Chris has this intimate experience with pipe organs.
Some kind of organ.
It's like playing a whole room, man.
I hadn't thought of that, but I like it. I do like it. And that's kind of the funny thing about this project for me also is that since we've been doing it for 2 years, I started writing it before Carly.
Yeah. You played us the unfinished demo in 2016. It was like fall 2016.
Yeah. So aspects of it have like revealed themselves to me. That's what's like kind of fucked up and weird.
I feel like as the three of us being students of literature, that's like, right? Authorial intent is the beginning, but not the end all, right? But
sure.
I love it.
No, for sure. But also it's a very real like writing phenomenon that like you write a song and you think it's about something, but it's something seems kind of weird and off. And then like months later, you're just like, oh shit, it's about my dog.
Yeah.
You know, like.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
Apparently, I'm being very pretentious today, but Oscar Wilde has some quote about how music is necessarily a collaborative art because, at the very least, even a solo artist is collaborating with a listener and creating meaning. So, something like this, you really can create a very fleshed out dramatic piece because you have players as vessels for that story, and necessarily everyone will interpret it differently.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
But really, stop bringing pretension into our
25 minute rock opera
based on Greek mythology.
My bad.
And drug use.
Yeah, that was a little self indulgent.
So what was the question? I'm sorry.
No, I think you got it.
The question was about...
No, what's happening in Darling?
Oh, yeah.
We were talking about wandering.
Yeah. So our main character is... So there is a god, because it is a myth, whose job is... Not job. Like a 9-to-5.
Well, he took Sundays off.
That would explain a lot about the universe, Sundays, though.
Yes. No, he subsists on the pain of mourning. And so... His job is to milk as much of it out of our main character as possible. And so he's setting him up for that by calling him to his, you know, den.
So, Harry, you had mentioned you got through about the first 15 minutes of this.
Yeah.
We're approaching that now, right? So was Darling of Mine kind of where it capped off, or had you gotten into the door a little bit too?
Yep. Nope. I hit Darling of Mine, and then I was like, I do not know what to do.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Enter Samuel D. Lupowitz. Yeah. So was the door more of a collaborative effort between you two also?
We sort of worked backwards from the section that followed. We needed a bridge between the you know, eerie seduction of Darling of Mine into what happens next. And I worked on the following section on Rock Bottom, and then Harry and I demoed it, and then Harry sent back a demo of, you know, the whole thing so far, and he had sort of created at home a little soundscape to bridge them. And then between playing it live and then having it in the studio, we sort of sculpted that, the what was called the spacey transition for a long time, but yeah,
for years
became until about like last week,
yeah.
When you decided it's called the door.
The door?
The door.
The door. Okay, it's called the door, yeah.
It's spacey transition to me.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. I saw that on the sheet, and I was like, what the fuck?
You know what? I said to Harry, you know what I love about it? Because the door makes me think of the Rodin, the sculpture of the gates of hell.
The gates of hell.
Speaking of being pretentious, we'll bring some French sculpture and some Dante into the mix here.
Mandy and Joe both, I feel... played with a lot of effects and soundscapes and that kind of thing here. How lengthy of a process was it for you to really find the right one? Or was it like, was it kind of, okay, I've got just a thing in mind, you know?
Well, originally we talked about having like a
a sample, right? That we were just gonna play. Yeah. And I was like, I can do some stuff for now if you want me to. So like, I'm basically just holding down my delay pedal that makes it keep going and then fading it in and out, which didn't really take that long to, I kind of knew, sure. Like once I heard the part and we talked about how we're gonna do it, I was like, this is could be a fun trick to do.
Yeah.
So. Did we end up, we had me sing into the piano.
Yeah.
Yeah, we might have a piano, and she sang into the soundboard rather than micro voice. Yeah.
Yeah. Did we keep that?
Yep. It's in there. It's mm-hmm. the effect. Like if you were to solo that vocal, you'd be able to hear it, and it sounds like a cool like amorphous reverb. But it is, it's pretty buried. Like that detail is buried within the in the whole mix now.
Yeah, it sounded really cool, like right up in when you had your head in the piano. It sounded really, really cool. But I think a lot of the rest of it was mostly it was really just like stuff Chris did, and well, I just sang a bunch of stuff.
We played around with Sam sent me like there's some noisy synth thing.
Yeah, I did a couple. I did some C-board stuff where it's just sort of like non-pitched notes that are like ascending and descending, and I manipulated them, and you hear it sort of toward the end of the climax, you hear it sort of making some like splattery noises that keep getting higher and higher but don't have a real pitch. But yeah, it's all sort of in the stew. There's nothing that's really like an individual element so much.
There's some little bits
in there. That session was just playtime. That was like,
yeah, that's the most fun.
Well, it was so too much like fun. I remember for all the stuff that we were sort of studioing later, that we were shaping after we did the initial, and this had no like core performance. It was when we were doing guitar overdubs. It was just Joe laid down the bed of guitars, and we kind of added everything to that. But you know, Harry had we had sort of a spreadsheet of like things we wanted to make sure we added. Either that we hadn't done with it live or that, you know, normally if I'm doing like a one hand on two different keyboards, I can like refine those parts individually a little more, that sort of thing. And Harry had a bunch of stuff, you know, he's like, oh, shaker on this part and, you know, glockenspiel here. And then on this one, he just had listed the sounds of an abattoir of suffering.
Of human suffering, yeah.
Like, oh, okay, well, we'll fire that up.
Work that up, yeah. My initial plan was to like find a sound bite or something.
Uh huh. Like some just like, found sounds.
We could just make it. We could just make a sound, the sound of human suffering.
Yeah, that's as analog as it gets. It's just human screaming.
Yeah.
And Chris, the first time I listened to this, I knew that was you. That low note during the door here.
Did the.
Yeah.
My voice, I have a distinctive character.
What? How did that happen? Just kind of like, how did that come together that he ended up lending his voice to this also?
I couldn't hit it. It was too low. And
yeah, right. You had the.
I was having an off day.
Harry Nichols kind of vocal. But yeah, I think you were trying to do it. And Chris said, I might have that. And we were happy. You know, he'd been a part of the process from when we came in here. So we're like, yeah, let's get you singing on there.
Yeah. Very nice. And I figured the scream was either Harry or Mandy.
If you had to guess, if you like gun to your head, which would you guess?
Well, I can't guess because I already know now. Actually. I found out before we started today.
Shit, guys.
He's all cocky over there. Who do you think it was?
No, I think like that's more of a like full-throated scream.
Yeah, But there's a lot of screaming under that, too.
Yeah. I could have seen Sam pulling that off, too, though. I'm not going to lie.
We're all, the three of us are all screaming.
We're all yelling.
Yeah.
We're adept screamers.
That's like one of the few times I felt like self-conscious recording was like doing that.
I remember you saying, we might need a little alcohol.
We all took shots of straight Bacardi rum before we did it.
That bottle is not yet emptied. It's huge and sitting right over there.
Which I will say, which we'll need to keep in mind for when we do our pirate rock opera next.
Bacardi is not pirate rum.
That's true.
The pirates did not drink white rum.
It's like a Key West pirate.
They're making daiquiris.
The new 15 history lesson.
I like your indignation on behalf of the pirates.
Yar, pass me another
daiquiri.
They were
drinking Kraken. Excuse me.
A whole bushel of apples.
And so the door itself and then the very scream that we just mentioned is the segue into part 7, which is Rock Bottom.
Hello!
And if you had told me Sam Lupowitz wrote one part of this, guess which one it is. You know, it's vintage. I'm curious, Sam, how much direction did Harry give you for like what he wanted this to be? Or was it just kind of like, Sam, give me something crazy, you know?
It wasn't even give me something crazy. What he said was after he played us the demo that went up through Darling of Mine, he said, and that's kind of where I'm stuck. I was hoping you guys could maybe help me out. And I think we said, cool. And then I think maybe like it was later, like a couple days or something. I probably just texted you and I was like, what happens next in the story? Like, where you're stuck? And you say, oh, the main character goes to the underworld. And I was like, got it.
Nailed it.
Cool. Yes. I'll write the part where we're in hell. I can do that.
What time signature is that?
It's a couple of them. Okay. It's mostly like it's in 4 except when it's not, which is rather than being in 1, it just adds a beat every couple of bars. I never like plotted it out. I just sort of like I knew where I wanted that extra beat to happen, and that sort of the riff drove it. I knew how I wanted it to push and pull the time.
Chris and I are both tapping it. It's an extra beat every 4 bars, I think.
Yeah, it's just every time it adds. And then, you know, then I start to play with it. But it was just, I was listening to a lot of Medeski, Martin, and Wood.
That's come up before.
Yeah. Yeah. And a lot of their stuff is like, it'll be a really like jazzy and very funky groove. A lot of time there's some like Latin influence and just some drums that pull you in. And then a keyboard or something will start playing a melody that is just fucked up. And you're seduced by this really danceable thing, and all of a sudden it's like this horrifying sound, but it's also really seductive. And I thought that was a great sort of metaphor for being drawn into the depths of your misery. Like, it's not just that something's off. It's also it's something that's drawing you in. Cause sometimes when you're miserable, sometimes nothing feels better than just deciding to completely fall into it. So that was my, you know, pretentious,
I think that's the very definition of rock bottom, actually.
How to build that. Yeah, exactly. And then Harry and I worked on it together. I remember I went over to his place and we made the demo together. But I must have had, like, I think most of the lyrics and like the structure, at least in my head, I don't think I've like played it very much. I think we sort of fleshed out the sound of it.
For some reason, I think you must have just come over and like played piano and sung.
Yeah.
To a click track or something.
Yes.
And
yeah, because you added, you did.
Because I like did a bunch of drum type stuff.
Yes. Yeah, because that was when you showed me how on all your demos you program the drum, you actually perform the drums by typing on your keyboard, and I was like, "Are you kidding me?" Like, you're like, "Yeah, here, watch." And then I tried to do it, and it was not that. And now we have Phil to do it, so that's much much better. But yeah, this is typically like, you know, it's a lot of sections and a lot of transitions, but learning the piece up to that point, other than a couple little tricky things, it's pretty straightforward. And then we get to the part that I write, and everything grinds to, okay, hold on. Who messed up that part? I'm not sure if it was me that time. But it was, I really liked that Harry trusted me. He had carried the idea so far. And he's just like, yeah, come up with something. Because it's exactly the kind of thing I like doing, the dark, spooky stuff.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, a little bit. I'm prone to it.
Phil, I mean, is there a playbook for breaking down a beat like this? I mean, what was your approach to kind of keeping it together during this section?
Messing it up a lot of times.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
He says without a trace of resentment in his voice.
Yeah. Yeah. And I always look for Joe's approval.
Me too.
If Joe's frowning, then I internalize that.
I'm usually frowning, though. You can't take that personally.
Which is why I'm never quite satisfied with my performances. But it's like burning yourself on the stove, you know, every time I screw that song up. So, you know, pain is a good reminder of how not to do something, you know. So, I think that's really, and how fitting for the whole theme of that section, right?
It sounds like you kind of just almost tried to break it down to a 1-1 beat and go from there.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. You know, I think it's a bit of that, and also just really locking in with the keys, which I feel like is what I listen to most on this one.
Joe, I really love, everybody was talking about the solo during Wandering, which is obviously great. I love what you're doing in the background here. It's like through spectrums, Joe, to me, you know?
Thanks.
I feel like in our past podcasts, I've spent a lot of time asking you about process and technique and all of that and what you do to approach it. I'm really just finding different ways to ask you the same question. What I want to hear you say, man, is like, Dan, I'm just really good at guitar. I don't know what to tell you, you know? For 13 years, Joe, that's all I've wanted to hear you say.
Wow.
But you're too pro for that. So with something like this, what particular inspirations can you say you pulled from going for this solo?
This came pretty quickly to me. I heard what I thought should happen. And it sort of goes back to like the Between Walls days for me. Like,
yeah.
It's similar, where I was encouraged to play more than maybe was appropriate. You think about it, you know, this section, you're in hell. So like, what do you picture? Like there's always got to be something that's kind of annoying you, right? Or something that's like just going on. Like, so enter the fuzz pedal, which, you know, is just fucking obnoxious overdrive, you know, distortion, and just sort of play kind of like most of the eighth notes with that. And
it's like kind of with the beat, but a little bit not, you know?
I love how it weaves around the vocal.
Yeah,
it's never in the way of the vocal.
And the idea was almost with that fuzz pedal, it's almost like you really got to kind of try to hear what's being played. It's more just like kind of going in and out and buzzing around. And then when Mandy's section comes in, it's a little bit more defined with the strat that I'm playing. But overall, the in my head came to me pretty quickly, and then it was just a matter of fitting it to that weird timing thing and making it work. And
like everyone else has commented, not walking all over the vocals at the same time.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's sort of, recording technique to sort of keep it a little bit lower in the mix. And a fuzz effect usually isn't what you want to have, like, total, like, clarity, you know? It's kind of like, I mean, it's meant to simulate a broken speaker. So
you had talked about that, like with the tick solo, almost wanting it to be a little
similar
obnoxious,
kind of thing,
right?
yeah but even more so in this case, because it's not really a solo, it's something going behind vocals. So
So Harry, back to, for a minute, you kind of turning a part of your baby over to Sam, right, to handle this here. How'd he do?
I love it. I love it. I don't really see any of my writing is like my baby. I don't know. It's hard to.
You are a very generous collaborator. Much more generous than.
But
me.
Like that's what I get.
Is he a generous lover? Was he a generous lover? I'm sorry.
No, you're not.
You know,
you're
I'm
not even a little bit sorry.
Mandy's been petting dogs, yeah. And now all bets are off.
It's like a drug.
She still doesn't know that. Yeah, doesn't
know. I'm high on puppies.
You picked up on it.
Tripping on puppies.
Sir Primus, too many puppies here.
Oh my God.
Ding, 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 ding.
I used to be obsessed with Primus.
I still love Primus.
Yeah, what is not to love?
That's the kind of shit that went into this part of the song.
This part's got a little Primus to it, for sure.
It's a little Primus-y, yeah, for sure.
If I could have sung it, like, just, if I sang, like Les Claypool, like, that would be okay.
Tommy was a kid.
Yeah. As it stands, it's, I think, my favorite vocal I've ever done, like, I've ever recorded. I'm so...
That, your vocal performance.
It sounds so dope.
Because it's my favorite kind of thing to do, because I'm not, like... I feel like my singing is a lot like my playing, where in what I lack in precision, I try to make up for in attitude. And something like this, that's all, like, it's a character, and it, you know, you're in hell.
Sure, it hurts, but you get used to it. Ain't this where it's at? You wanna be where it's at? Oh, come on!
I was channeling a little bit. There's an episode of Futurama where Bender goes to robot hell, and the robot devil sings a song to welcome him to robot hell, and it's Dan Castellaneta, who does the voice of Homer Simpson, right, singing as the robot devil. That was sort of my... I just went way over the top, and it was so much fun.
Cigars are evil. You won't miss them. We'll find ways to simulate that smell. What a sorry fella. Rolled up and smoked like a panicella. Here on level one of robot hell.
I definitely picture you with like a top hat on and like the suit jacket with the tails like spinning the, you know.
Oh, I like that. You could do that for me. Mm-hmm. Sometime.
Top hat, suit jacket, tail.
10-gallon hat.
Nothing else.
Nothing.
It's got a very, please don't take any offense to this. But for me, it's such a Tim Burton-y section. I don't know. It's like,
yes, it is.
But and that's what I love about it. Like, yeah, good Tim Burton. Edward Scissorhands. Not like, you know. I don't know. It's no, that's what I love about it. It's just, it's kind of a left turn where you need a left turn, I think.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, absolutely. Side note, and forgive me if this is a stupid question, but toy piano, I'm literally picturing a Fisher Price piano.
It's here.
That's correct.
It's over there.
It's right there.
Go get it.
Let's put it on the
It may not be
table.
Brand, yeah, like, trademark Fisher Price, but...
Oh, yeah, sorry. A child's generic brand.
Schoenhut.
That's it.
Hello! Hey! Come on!
Harry, you sounded like a Muppet.
Hello! It's very Muppety.
Hello!
Like, all my campy influences.
Welcome
and then
Rock
I play
Bottom.
A talk box solo. Like, I just so many, like,
so good,
inappropriate things, and it all seemed to work.
Welcome to Rock Bottom, my baby.
Well, we know that you just can't help yourself. And speaking of which, I have this written down, so I'm going to go through it. In order of appearance, we have Samuel B. Leupowitz on Wurlitzer, organ, piano, seaboard, Moog, hand claps, glockenspiel, pipe organ, toy piano, mellotron flute samples, talkbox, chimes, background vocals, lead vocals, and writing credits. Is that a record for you on one song?
On on one song, probably. Yes.
One album?
I think the pipe organ, if nothing else, I mean, takes me to beyond
that's
the
next level
levels
shit
of excess I've gone to before.
I'm pretty sure he's brought all that stuff to a gig once, probably.
Has to run a moving truck for
the pipe organ backs up on a flatbed.
We were talking about like a timeshare van for all of the bands.
We just have
that
a gig in Hampshire.
Can you imagine? I mean, we've joked about this sort of thing before. Can you imagine if we're like, when we do the release show for this, I'm like, all right, guys, can you help me carry the pipe organ up the?
You got to disassemble it and put it back together in the range, like
up to the VFW.
Load in. VFW is the best. Would be the best.
That's the site of our best show ever.
Wing Night.
Where we were shown up by the closer, which was Wing Night.
That's not like, a band, by the way.
Yeah, not a band.
You mean Wing Nut? Oh, hold on.
Nope.
That should be our alter ego, our band that just plays Southern rock covers. We just call it Wing
Night.
Still warm too, Sweet Home Alabama.
That's a great band name. Oh, you get a lot of people, though, at your show that are like really pissed.
Yeah.
But we get that anyway. That was what we got at that show. So.
You thought you were getting wings tonight. No, here's our 25-minute rock opera.
I had a guitar.
Extra spicy.
A guitar player I played with in high school wanted to call our band Keg Party so he could just put posters up. And I think he did at one point put posters up around our high school, and he got in a lot of trouble for that.
Yeah.
Like, oh, it's my band's show. Everyone showed up. Like, where's the beer? And we're like, hi, we're Keg Party.
Free beer would be another good one.
Yes. Yeah.
So from Rock Bottom, we go into My Ghost.
I got my ghost. I got my ghost.
Wrapping it all up here, right? Harry, did you have any sense in the beginning of how you wanted to wrap it up?
No, I had no idea coming out of Sam's section. We had the trend. Did we have the transition out of it, or did I come up with that?
You came up with that riff rock. That's sort of, and the thing I love too that we worked out. Because I came in with like the rock bottom part, and then you and I sort of got that rock bottom intro together. And then later you came up with the riffy part that came out of it. And what I love about it is that the riff going into hell goes upward, and then getting out of hell goes downward. Yeah. It's this weird topsy-turvy.
Yeah, it's weird, yeah.
I love it. So yeah, so that was you getting us out of there. Mm-hmm.
So you had none of this even before, until after Rock Bottom was
I kind of started with music first and let the lyrics kind of come afterwards. My original intention was to have it be a happier ending than it is. It's a really brutal ending.
That's what I was going to ask. We don't really have a happy ending here, do we?
No, it's terrible. it turns out that the entire story up to this point has been kind of a flashback in retrospect being told to somebody else years later. And the person who is our main character, who has been to hell and had to sort of make this decision about whether or not to, stand still, or to just who is stuck standing still in the decision whether or not to cling to the past or move on, just kind of didn't make a decision, and now they're sort of stuck in that crisis forever, and they're just...
Is that what the ghost is? Kind of that crisis?
Yeah. Well, the ghost is the, end, is the memories, is the... Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure.
And Sam, to your end too, musically, just... there is a little bit of familiarity at the end.
Mm-hmm.
How did you work through kind of bringing everything back together composition-wise?
Well, I think Harry mostly had the structure of this section all fleshed out. But, you know, there's that moment after the first chorus sort of when it comes down to just piano. And I think Harry had, on his demo, had played piano just sort of playing the chords. And I felt like I wanted something, like that little chord progression happens earlier in the tune too, but I wanted something that really brought us back full circle a little bit. So I figured out, I figured if I played that, the initial Time For Me theme, which is hidden in a lot of the
pieces subtle,
throughout, that would be a good moment to sort of work it in. I wasn't sure if it would work playing those same chord changes with that melody over it, but it turned into a really cool kind of recontextualization of that initial idea. It became sort of the main theme of this character and of the piece, so I was really pleased with that. And I sneak it in a couple other places, like right at the very end, that it's hidden behind some of the other chords. I'm also a musical theater person, and I think as far as my contribution arrangement-wise to tying it together and making it more of a whole, is something I'm always looking to do, even when we're not doing a 25-minute, through narrative.
That was something that really jumped out at me. I mean, I'm not a musician. obviously, but it's not that it was the same chord progressions at the end, but it just felt familiar.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can't really put my finger on it beyond that. And just
yeah.
like it,
well, good.
It really did just kind of all wrap up there.
I feel like it feels like a Golden Slumbers kind of moment, like that big vocal over the piano. And I feel like that the first time I heard it, I felt like it had that like big Beatles Paul McCartney piano closer feel to it, and that kind of like puts you in this like contextual familiarity.
As we mentioned a couple times, we're of course here at Sunwood Studios in Trumansburg, and up until this point, Sam has been handling the recording, the engineering, all of that, and we've talked before about how he, as you do when you do something a lot, continues to get better with it and grow and all that. What was it that made you want to kind of step outside the box for this project?
step outside the box. That's funny.
It was a really ambitious undertaking, and I did not want to be trying to figure out how to record this beast and think about performing it. I wanted some. But our initial plan was to find a studio where we could lay down the skeleton, and then we'd go back and I would be the insane person again.
Okay.
And then after we spent our day doing that, I remember Harry was kind of like, I would kind of love to keep working with, because Chris just made it so easy for us to come in and do the thing we wanted to do. It was like open and had ideas, but was willing to follow us even when it seemed like what we were doing was crazy. It was really welcoming. And it's funny because the real reason, other than me not wanting to do it, I was just like, we need to do it in a studio where I can play a piano next to the drum set in the same room. That was my...
I was wondering how you landed on this one specifically.
There needed to be a piano. That was my... the rule that I laid down.
Mm-hmm. Well, we heard good records from...
Yeah.
From
yeah.
here. Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Other people looked for like the substance of the studio. I was like, find a place with a piano. Call me when you do.
Yeah, that's right.
I'll be in my chambers.
And so, Chris, other than the obvious parts, right? It's your studio, you're running everything. What did you feel you were really able to contribute to this project?
I mean, I like being kind of a behind-the-scenes coach. And some projects that I work on with some bands, like, people are looking for musical guidance, which I'm happy to offer, and I, you know, as a multi-instrumentalist can like contribute in those. Yeah, I'm able to offer those things, but I also like, clearly you guys all had a vision for this and the demo, and so I felt like you knew what parts you wanted to be in there, so rather than be like, why don't you guys try this instead, I really wanted to just coax whatever the best performances of what you were. Try to internalize your vision and coax the best performances out of you for each of the elements that we added, even if it was something as simple as like hand claps or a tambourine. Like that was how I felt. Like you had the vision and I was the kind of just behind the scenes coach.
Nice.
There's a lot of butt slapping.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Behind the scenes coach got a little handsy.
Lots of hazing.
Lots of dog petting.
Yes. Late night dog petting sessions.
So for, I guess for kind of Harry and Sam both, it may be a Rorschach thing that I kind of hear what I want to hear, but I can point out three specific references to The Wall in this song.
Interesting.
What concept albums for each of you guys have kind of led you here? Like what have you used to build this, you know?
So, I mean, the concept albums that I kind of clung to as a kid, so The Wall was one of them.
And the three of us have a special history with that one, too.
Sure, yes. Yeah. I can almost remember it.
I feel like I can answer this question for Sam.
Yeah, that'll be an interesting game.
Yes.
It'll be like
let's try that.
The newlywed game.
A first Sam concept album influence, absolutely. Jesus Christ Superstar. Have you forgotten how put down we are? I am frightened by the crowd, for we are getting much too loud. And they'll crush us if we go too far. If we go. And Hazards of Love, The Decemberists. That's very akin to this.
Hazards of Love specifically, and a couple of their other more conceptual pieces I definitely brought to the fore. I do have a couple of very specific, very on-the-nose references to Rick Wakeman's playing in Yes. There are a couple of the mellotron flutes, and there's some little organ touches that I do, particularly towards the end, that are just direct lifts from things that he did on Roundabout and that Fragile, that early Rick Wakeman Yes period. And that was sort of my tip of the hat to, you know, legendary
to that
prog band. Yeah.
a lot of concept albums you listen to and have no idea what the fuck is going on. And so but then again, if they're too explicit,
yeah, you don't want to be too literal.
I don't like that either. So like I've written concept albums before and usually have thrown them away because I don't like what I find. So this is like one of the first ones that I'm actually getting done, which is really cool. In writing this, though, I didn't really consider it a concept album. I considered it a song, a suite,
yeah.
You know? So, like, really, I was more pulling from, like, the second half of Abbey Road and, like, other sort of longer works that, I don't know, are not necessarily, like, unified concepts, even though this one is, you know? I do feel, though, that it doesn't sound, because I was still figuring out how I wanted to write for Noon 15. So, like, I don't think that it really necessarily sounds as Noon 15-y. As like,
which is one of the things I like about it personally, because I like we've talked about how we've spent time, you know, trying to make sure there is a core sound for this band. I think what makes it Noon 15 is that we all throw something into the mix, and I love that it's not too. It sounds like something we wrote, not something we were trying to write for Noon 15 necessarily. Right. Just that it is what it came to be, and I think it just sort of expands the palette of what we do, which is I love. You know, before we played music in bands together, I was just a fan of what you did, and so that's like selfishly, I just want to like play all that shit.
So back to Harry now. I mean, like you said, we're almost 3 years in the making here, right? How does the finished product, now that we have it, right? How does it match up to what you had always thought of?
Oh man, no, it exceeds my expectations. Yeah. I'm really, really pleased with it.
Were there ever times that you questioned, like, all right, this is too much, this is too crazy, you know? Or was it always like, no, we can do this?
Did I say that this time? Did I ever, like... I have in the past been like, guys, tell me if this is getting to be too much. But I feel like on this, kind of all the stoppers were out, you know? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, well, when we were all... If there were any moments where you doubted our ability to do it, I think we were all on Team Go for it, you know?
Yeah.
So I think if there were any...
If anything, I don't think I would have doubted anyone the ability to do it as much as just, like, making sure it's, like, tonally what I'm looking for. You know what I mean? Like, it's, like, really a matter of taste more than ability.
The writing... Your writing of this obviously coincided with when Noon 15 got together. Do you think you could have done this with any of your previous bands?
Oh God, no.
No, I mean I'm speaking, that speaks to these folks, not to, you know, those
folks. Right.
And
no, I don't think I could have. No.
Yeah.
I
mean,
it's a pretty simple answer.
It's this whole group. Yeah.
It's the group.
That's great. And so Phil, we had talked before about you kind of in the first part of the Finish What You Started podcast, we had talked a little bit about how you're kind of used to being thrown curveballs, you know?
Sure am.
A little bit of everything here and there. What was your reaction to being presented with this? Like they said, your very first gig. I mean, this was like one of the first things you had to learn. Are you like, oh my God, what have I gotten myself into? Or
a little bit of that. You know, I was like at you know, it was a bit of foreshadowing actually, for sure, because like that's been my experience with this band since. You know, it was like that, more of that sort of stuff. Little did I know at the time.
Whoops.
But, you know, I was like, yeah, let's do it. You know, I didn't really think all that much of it. And then I think you guys mentioned shortly after that you were working on another one. And I was like, oh, cool.
Yes, there is another one.
Yeah, Harry wrote another one.
So, yeah, you know.
It's in the queue.
I feel like with this group,
side
though.
Side B to the record.
Right? Yeah, side A. With this group, though, Phil, maybe like when you were like, yeah, I'm ready to come on board, you almost had to be ready for anything.
Yeah, for sure. That's definitely the case, but also I think, you know, the atmosphere is just, you know, it's really great. You know, working together, working with these guys is just a lot of fun. These folks. But I you know, there's always plenty of acknowledgement of all the crazy shit that is thrown, you know, around the room, you know, and at each other and all the crazy shit. And so that makes it okay. There's, yeah, you know, good amount of recognition, I think.
Like, we know this is nuts, but we're nuts. Here's what we're doing.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, oh, Sam's usually, I just want to say, guys, I really appreciate all the hard work. I know it's been a lot. And I'm like, that makes me feel better.
We thank each other a lot.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. For sure. It's like eating a lot of food and the poop that comes.
I didn't quite see where you were going with that at first, but...
And that's where it all comes down. All of our ambition, all of our collaboration comes down to a poop joke at the end.
Everybody make sure to listen to our piece of poop, our latest piece of poop that we just put out.
The 25 minute.
That's right. It's coming down the pipes.
We'll be squeezing that out on November 31st.
So as...
Podcast jokes.
It's time now to hear At the Festival from Noon 15. We have Mandy Goldman on vocals, Samuel B. Lupowitz on keys and vocals, Joe Massa on guitars, Harry Nichols on bass, percussion, and vocals, Phil Shea on drums and vocals. At the Festival, recorded here at Sunwood Studios in Trumansburg from Noon 15.
She'll come back for Ragnarok. Maybe I'll wait here until the day I'm good at standing still. Anyway as a take
down my pills all one by one. Take some time for me. Can you blame me? Take some time for me today. Take some time for me. Can you blame me? Gonna shake this blues away.
How did these stars land direction chaos, perfection, I will fold. What was your name? Won't you tell me? I don't recall. Maybe it's best if I don't use names at all. Out in this eternal desert, it's so cold. Into your chaos, perfection, I will fall. See your chaos, perfection, I will fall.
Sleep and follow me yonder. your sympathetic heart. Good riddance. 'Cause I don't need you. I don't need anyone. I got my ghost. I got my ghost. And it was all so long ago.
Thanks for listening to the Noon 15 podcast. Visit noon15.com to subscribe and for more music, videos, and info on upcoming shows. If you like what you hear, tell your friends and leave us a review on iTunes. Tune in next time for another trip behind the scenes with Noon 15.
Well,
now we record all of our auxiliary special effects, right?
I'll sample all of them.
Well, Dan, thanks a lot, buddy.
Dude, my
thanks.
Pleasure, man.
It's always a pleasure.
Nice bottle.